So firstly, let's ask the doubts that you may have about the practice that you've done all day. So any doubt that you have about the meditation. Just a minute. Lo digo primero en inglés. Sí, y luego te lo. Lama Zopa, I believe that our Vipassana and Shamatha meditation is still very fragile. Therefore, we need to be in a silent and peaceful area to strengthen it, and especially to understand the emptiness and apply it. This climate full of external factors, such as the air conditioning, can really help us perceive the emptiness of all situations and overcome any of them. Or are these factors disturbing our minds? Should we take them as tests or not now? Thank you. So, vale. La pregunta es, sé que nuestra meditación de Vipassana y Shamatha son muy frágiles en estos momentos, o aún, estamos en un lugar tranquilo para reforzar la meditación y especialmente entender la vacuidad. El hecho de tener el aire acondicionado, el ruido, puede ayudarnos a percibir la vacuidad o en la meditación de todas las situaciones, o es un factor que nos puede interrumpir nuestro estado mental. ¿Tendríamos que tomarlo como una prueba o ahora aún no es el momento? Es más que nada el ruido. Si lo toma como una prueba o...
Yeah.
So if it's respect with the about the noise, it's normal that at the beginning if a person hasn't meditated, any noise can disturb him. There is a practice of meditation about the sounds, the objects of the ears, about the noises. Because here in this retreat we have a little special condition, silence. It's a silent place, so we had to put this air conditioning because people are hot, and it does make a little noise. But can we practice even with the noise? Yes, we can. Yes, perfectly. Simply.
No,
without judging or emitting or analyzing it too much. It's like if you just analyze it constantly and judge it, then when you go outside also there will be a lot of noise, not just the air conditioning. But the noise of a... So there will be many noises. So I understand that if a person hasn't meditated a lot, there may be hard, but still it's good that you get used to it. Here, because there is silence, but you still can practice at home with the noise. Because imagine that you are at home and you are meditating and maybe you have noises, the neighbors, a child crying, the noise of the cars. So if we had to, or even in a mountain, You go to a mountain thinking that there will be no noises, and then the birds start singing in the morning. So on the one sense, it's like, okay, then the birds, it's nice, the birds singing, and maybe we'll get attached to it. So it's possible to do it with noise, to meditate with noises. So when you're attentive to your breathing, for example, I'm mindful about the breath, and I can also hear the noise, but still be attentive to the breathing. I don't judge whether I like it or not, because this is what we are constantly doing in our daily lives. I like it, I don't like it. If I like it, maybe without realizing, maybe I get attached to that, because I am overvaluating the object, and this without realizing, actually we do it. And whenever I don't like something, then I create aversion, and these are the basic emotions most that we use so much, and they can cause a lot of suffering when we get attached to things, or when we feel that we reject things. So here, so whenever we practice shamatha and in the future vipassana, then obviously there will be noises from the kitchen, from outside, and from the air conditioning. But don't do anything with it, and there is no problem. The problem is when I do something in my mind, and I create a version, for example, there, here, it would be the problem. The problem is not in the thoughts that are coming, or the emotions that come, or the memories that come. The problem is what I do with this. How do I react to that? That's the problem. Here we have the problem, actually, because in our daily lives it's going to be the same thing. Don't think that the ones that we are that are practicing like a spiritual path that is bringing the mind inwards, that is a spiritual person and takes the mind inwardly to understand the truth inside, that's a spiritual person. But that does this doesn't mean that because we practice this or meditate or other techniques, we are not going to find problems outside in our daily lives. That would be really nonsense, actually, because we will meet many problems, things that we don't really want. But our spiritual practice can help us to deal with all this, to face all these things. Otherwise, if we don't learn how to face it and not react to all these things with balance, then it can create a lot of suffering. So now the noise of the AC, the noise of the kitchen, or maybe if it would be raining a lot here, it would be a lot of noise. Because it's like the roof is would make a lot of noise. So it's normal that at the beginning, if we are not used to, in our lives also, that anything disturbs us. So we have to get used to it and understand it. And then after, they won't disturb us, these noises. Yeah, just noises. So when a person learns how to meditate well, the noise outside generates more silence, inner silence inside oneself. The more things outside, the more inner calmness is there.
Entonces,
So now, when we put the AC, just be relaxed. I always put an example very significative. Imagine that you are in a park, sitting on a bench, and you are resting, and then many people come in, for any kind of people, mothers with children, people going for walking, couples, and imagine that you are there sitting, and we are looking at these people. Some people come, others go. So when I went to India, something claimed my attention. I sat down and I observed so many people coming and going, so many people, never quiet there. So your mind is quiet. You are not verbalizing, thinking, oh, look at that, judging, like look at this woman, the way it goes, look at the child, look at this, that. No, just observe it, the way it comes and goes. The same as when you are sitting on meditation, you are attentive, mindful to your breathing. And it's difficult that we are in a place that there is no noise. So when you do your personal practice at home and you take the noise as the object of meditation to be able to familiarize yourself with it, then it won't disturb you. So here, do the same. There is no problem. Just don't be with the noise. Obviously, you'll hear it. And you'll feel your body and you'll feel the pain on the knees and you'll feel the memories, but you don't do anything. You are mere spectators. You are not affected. You are not judging like, oh, they put again, you know, the AC, I can meditate now. So this is what you should avoid, or maybe a memory from the past. And now, and when a memory comes, then maybe you grasp at that thought, why should I remember that, this right now? So I can avoid that memories come or thoughts come. I can avoid feeling a pain in my body. I can avoid that a person starts crying because, you know, emotions comes up or that breath is too strong. That's very difficult. But I'm going to be mindful, attentive, because my five sensorial consciousness are open, so I can't stop thinking, listening, etc. So just practice this patience so you can deal with it. And when you do this, you'll see that there will be no problems. But if I start saying, no, with this noise, I can't do it, then for sure you won't. For sure. So, please be patient. And Vipassana, Shamatha Vipassana is a technique that I'm doing here. And I talked already what is Shamatha Vipassana. In a simple sense and deep sense. I said it yesterday. Obviously, the practices, all the teachings that Buddha gave, the 84,000 teachings that he gave, are directed to understand the ultimate nature of our minds, the emptiness. But before we reach there, we should work a lot. It's not that easy. Obviously, to get over to these noises, and you can get over this, and not just this noise, the noise of words, harsh words, when people tell us harsh words. We should be ready, prepared, in a state of mind that those words don't hurt us, and be able to react to these situations in a balanced way. because those words are just sounds, like the sound of the AC. But one word comes into my ear and alterates my mind, disturbs my mind. It comes through the consciousness of my ear and alters my mind. So we should prepare, and we can prepare, because any time that these words can come, then my mind can understand what happens. The sound is impermanent, is transitory. Those words come from a person that is not at that moment stable in his or her mind. Maybe it's like a disturbing emotion, an affliction that he has or she has. It's maybe the person is angry or sad, exactly, and he said these words. So this patience that I'm going to practice and learn to practice, this mental state that has nothing to do with suppressing. It's a stable mind that totally understands what's going on, to react with balance. One has to learn to generate this mind. See? Otra. I learned, just a minute, I learned to meditate with my with open eyes. I see a lot of people with eyes closed. What do you think? I sometimes have problems with lethargy and my mind sinks. What do you recommend? Aprendí a meditar con mis ojos abiertos. Veo a mucha gente con los ojos cerrados. ¿Cómo es mejor hacerlo? A veces tengo problemas de letargia, de letargo, mi mente se hunde. ¿Qué me recomiendas?
So just now I wanted to tell you about the posture of meditation and the
so I'm going to talk about the posture. There is a correct posture, which is the classical one that you all know probably. That is double lotus, sitting here the way I'm doing. I do half lotus. I don't do the full lotus posture. With the hands in this posture, which is the mudra, universal mudra, is the equilibrium, meditative equilibrium of meditative stabilization. And so it's double lotus, the hands on like 4 centimeters under the navel, with the thumbs touching. I'm gonna show the 7-point Vairochana, which is the correct posture, and then everybody does whatever you can. So, but 7-point of Vairochana, and if we include the breathing, then it would be 8 points. So the minds, the hands are in this posture. And then this has an incredible sense. This is what I learned. So the thumbs shouldn't be like mountain or a plane. Like they should be plane, like a horizontal. The pressure with each thumb is as if it was as if I had a paper between my thumbs and it's not falling down. So I memorize this posture. The back, the spine, it's totally straight. So that it's important that the cushion is very important for the spine to be straight.
If I don't use the cushion, then my spine curves backwards. It's not straight. Just when I sit on the cushion with my coccyx, then the knees are touching the floor and my back is straight naturally. It's a very stable posture. I don't have to do any kind of effort to straighten my spine, which from the 7 points, that's the most important one. And then the chin, the head is alineated, not going down. So this means that the spine is curved, and then the subtle channels. So we have inside our body, we have a subtle body, which and a subtle mind. That it has subtle channels, subtle prana, which is the chi that goes through the subtle channels. And this subtle air acts as a horse. And above this horse is the mind rides this horse. So these subtle airs. So if the channels are obstructed, then these subtle airs won't go well through the channels. So when the spine is straight, the channels go straight, and the airs, the subtle airs, also circulate well, and then the mind gets stable naturally. But if I put my body in this way, curving my spine, going forward, going to my forward, then we won't feel well. We want to stabilize our minds. I won't talk too deeply on the reason why we do these 7 points of Vairochana. I just tell you the most important one. When you do this posture, the reason to do it is because the channels are much better stabilized, and the prana circulates very well inside the channels, and the mind gets quieter. Very, very quickly. So the spine is straight. The chin is not upwards, not too much down, but it's just a little bit, slightly, going inwards. The tongue touches the palate, like where the teeth, upper teeth, start. There is no effort to close the mouth. Everything is relaxed, and there is a perfect alineation in the body. The eyes, just a little close, semi-closed, so just a meter from you. So whoever wants to do it this way, whoever wants to close them, there is no problem. But whenever you are at home, when there is not so many distractions, then just let the eyes a little bit open, so a little bit of light comes in. As I said right now, as the person who asked the question, he's used to meditate with a little bit open eyes. So that's good, because this will ameliorate the fact that you don't fall asleep, and your concentration, which is the clarity, mental clarity. So what? Now you can do it if you want. Just let your mind just let your eyes go down. But the mind is inwardly, looks inwardly. So the arms, they are not close to your body, they are actually outward, separated. When you memorize this posture, and something very important is that the hands, they should be supported on the heels, or you can put some cushion or some cloth where the hands are supported. If the hands are not supported, then there, you will create tension on your shoulders. So they should be supported. Also is correct one or two times in the meditation to take your attention to the body to see how is your posture and corrected it. You can do that. Because maybe the thumbs go upwards like a mountain, so this maybe means that maybe I'm too tense. But if it's the opposite, if they fall down, that this means that I enter into laxity, into sloth. So, but if I see that my thumb separate means that maybe I'm falling asleep. So memorize the posture slowly, because it's important at the beginning. If you do it at home, slowly you will memorize this posture. Also, you can put your hands on the knees. It's good that in the posture there is equilibrium and harmony. Actually, the most important thing about the meditation is what you do with your mind, but the posture is something that helps you, the same way that helps you to create an atmosphere where you are comfortable. You can use a candle, an incense. All this can help your meditation or to enter into the meditative state. So, but if we are, so the meditation posture can inspire you also, your mind, help your mind to go inwardly when you are in your daily life, in the streets, coming and going, then it's more difficult than when you are sitting down with the right posture. So when I meditate here, my posture helps that I have more attention, more introspection, helps my meditation. So these are the 7 points. Can you do half lotus? Yes, you can. So when there is balance, any posture, the most important one is the back. That you are, whether you are sitting on a chair, on a cushion, there should be equilibrium and the spine should be straight. Because it helps us to stabilize the subtle layers of the body. It helps. If sometimes you are sick and you are on the bed, can you meditate? Of course you can. Yes, the meditation, you do it with the mind. You can bring your attention to the breathing. But this is when you are sick, but not as a habit, because that posture will make probably that you fall asleep.
Entonces, con respecto a la postura, ¿tenéis alguna pregunta?
Do you have any question with respect to the posture?
Sí. Okay. Entendí. Yo antes de entrar, de llegar al monasterio, estuve haciendo mucha.
Before coming to the monastery, I did many years of meditation then, and my left hand. They taught me to put my left hand on top of the right one. But when I reached the monastery, they told me the opposite. And then I said, well, now I got used to this, and now I say that whatever, it doesn't matter. There should be balance, that's it, equilibrium. So did you understand well the posture? But now, I mean, you can just modify this posture because if, for example, you are sitting on this bench, so that's good as well, because your spine is straight and your spine is relaxed and there is no tension. So the monks then taught me that the posture of the body, the tension that should have, is the following one. When you are very tense, you cannot meditate. It has to be a posture where the body is good, is well, is straight, but in a relaxed state. Imagine an arc. The rope of the arc shouldn't be too tense. Should be the right strength. So inside yourself, you should feel also. So when is better to meditate, and how long you should meditate? For me, it's better to do it in the morning for many reasons. In the morning, you are resting, the body is rested, and at night you have supposedly rested. So when you do it in the morning, you stabilize your mind for the rest of the day. If I have a calm mind, alert, that day it's going to be, you start the day in a good way, that day it's going to be good. So if there is a problem, then you'll take it with tranquility, you won't react with anger or attachment. We'll have a more malevolent mind to solve problems. If we don't do it and we wake up with a restless mind, and we go to work, anything that any problem, whatever small it is, it can disturb more our mind. So in the morning it's good to do this practice of meditation. From my side, I recommend it. But if one wants to do it in the afternoon, it's also good. And also a little bit before going to sleep. To go to sleep well. 10 minutes. So with an open mind, feeling your breath, so that everything calms down, the tension of the day, the body, the mind. So you relax the body and mind, like the one that we do at the beginning. And if you go to bed with this state of tranquility, because the mind is a continuum, mental continuum, when we fall asleep, because the gross consciousness, they stop there, they finish. The consciousness, subtle consciousness, carry on, and the last minute, the last minute before we fall asleep, is going to be the first moment of the sleeping. So if I enter into sleep in a calm mind, then we will rest at night. But if my mind is agitated before going to sleep, and we fall asleep with this stressed mind or agitated mind, when I fall asleep, then the night, it's going to be agitated also, and I won't rest as well. The nature of our mind is just a mental continuum. When we go to sleep, the gross consciousness, the consciousness of the five consciousness disappear at that moment. It's as if we were death, but our consciousness keeps going. So that's the reason why you should go to sleep with a calm mind. And the last moment before waking up is the first moment that's going to be when you wake up. If we have slept well, and we have, then we wake up early. We don't wake up agitated. So for how long? That depends on each individual. As a foundation, it's much better the quality than the quantity. And the ideal is that our meditation be continuous, like a drop of water. The people who are starting, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and slowly you can do more. The people who are more time here can do more, so it depends on the time that you are meditating. With respect to this, do you want to ask some question? Do you have some doubt? You know, you all know the qualities that the meditation has, benefits at the physical and mental levels. Physical level, then our health will increment. And in a mental level, it will stabilize our mind. These states that we have as a roller coaster. Sometimes we are really happy, excited, sometimes we are depressed. This will balance itself with the meditation. At the physical level, the science say how many benefits it has in the stress, anxiety, the way that it's used. Also in many diseases such as cancer, etc. And also with the conventional medicine, the development of attention, mindfulness. And it's very beneficial, the mindfulness. Calm abiding is more powerful, Ansha. So you develop more qualities than practicing mindfulness. So the meditation brings so many benefits to your life.
Cuanto más desarrollado.
the more you develop your attention, the attention that you develop is memory. The more you develop your memory means that can be preventive of the senile sickness where we lose our memories. But also it brings calm, peace, our disturbing emotions, the attachment, hatred, ignorance is also balancing because there is more clarity in our minds. Pride, jealousy, avarice, and the fears that come from all this, and so many sickness, mental sickness, anxiety, stress. All this comes from not having an equilibrated mind, and not knowing how to deal with the situations in our everyday life. So there will be a lot of benefit. So when you are attentive to the breath, then the attachment will diminish when we are attentive to the breath. And when the attachment diminishes, which is this disturbing emotion, that makes the people or the objects that the thinking that from them the happiness comes, the happiness that you are looking for, that you're searching for. So this attachment is something that makes us see things that they don't exist, that are not there. That's why we get attached to it. It makes us see that all the good qualities come from the part of the object, being an animal, a person, or an object. And it makes us to get attached to that. With the meditation, it's going to diminish this ignorance. This attachment will diminish. So you're going to, and then you're going to relate with the objects in a more balanced way. So the only thing that it's going to diminish is what the mind superpose on the objects, the qualities, the good qualities that it doesn't really have, that we think that our happiness comes from those objects, and we don't see that it's our mind, it's inside our mind that the happiness is created when our mind is stable, actually. We don't see the relation of interdependence between our mental states and our happiness or suffering. And because we don't understand this, then we make it come from outside. And obviously, we will deal with the situations much better when we develop this attention. The attention, it's going to be an appropriate attention, correct state attention that relates to the world. When our senses relate to those objects, then they will relate in a correct way, and they'll be able to enjoy the world in a correct way, and we'll be able to find in the world whatever we need to live, to cover our necessities. We can be happy. What makes us unhappy is when we have these mistaken minds and we get attached to those. When we generate aversion, when the things that we want doesn't happen, or when we meet with the things that we don't like. We don't like the ups and downs, but there are going to be. We should be prepared for that. You should only have a balanced mind, nothing else. to be able to live our lives from that with a balanced mind, which is very close to who you really are, very close to your real essence. That's why I told you that the meditation is the tool that will help you to eliminate the veils, whatever disturbs our minds, that doesn't let us be happy. The mistakes of our own minds because of the ignorance, the one that doesn't let us be happy. Our ignorant mind doesn't let us see the incredible qualities that we have as human beings, and then we identify with a part so inferior of what we really are. We identify ourselves with our past, with our families, with what we are. We identify with our richness, with our power, with our bodies, with our thoughts, with our emotions. We make our identity with things that are not even in there. They are memories from the past. So we make our identity, that is what we believe we are, on iron pillars, and our ignorance doesn't let us see where we should support ourselves so that they are pillars, solid pillars that are inside ourselves, that there are so many strengths inside us. And the path to be able to reach there, to contact with that essence, with those qualities incredible that we have as human beings. The meditation is fundamental, because this is the one that makes you go inside, to look inside, to understand. When you understand your mind, you understand how you really truly exist, and how all these values can emerge, all this resilience, all these strengths to confront the complicated moments that life brings us, because all these things will come. We'll always find things that we don't want, and the things that we want hardly will come. So we have to be prepared, we have to have a strong mind, stable, clear, to have all these values, all these qualities, inequalities, good heart. The qualities of the heart are incredible. So just to have a good heart, a compassionate heart, goodness, compassion, altruism, the mind that loves others, and without wisdom, even if we have this kind of mind, without wisdom we will keep suffering. We need wisdom. We need to understand how things truly are. Who am I? How is the life? How is the world where I live in? To be able to live from there, so with all these two things, then we can truly live with a good heart, a heart with wisdom. These are the two wings that the bird flies, and then we can face life. Sometimes, people say, "Oh, they are good people. These people are very good. Why do they suffer so much?" Well, because wisdom is lacking. This wisdom is the one that will make you put the limits. love and compassion can protect also from your own selfish mind. The wisdom will protect from the selfishness of others. To know when we shouldn't suffer, because we should put the limits with respect to our relationship with others. How to protect us, ourselves also. So the wisdom will teach us how to protect ourselves. When we'll be prepared with a good heart, with equanimity, good compassion, this will protect us from our own selfishness, the egocentric mind. Hedonism and egocentricness are different, but from the two, it's going to protect us. To believe that we're the center of the world and just look out at just our own selves. And the wisdom that is to understand, this is the one that's going to help you how to live. So there are so many qualities. Actually, we are in a Buddhist monastery. Do you know what Buddhist means? Nalanda, which means a person who searches the truth inside oneself. Buddha means awakened. That's Buddha. Here behind me, I have 1,001 images of Buddha, which are the symbolic representations. The real Buddha, the potential Buddha, is inside yourselves. Years ago, the Prince Siddhartha, one time in his life, he wanted to understand why human beings suffered and how to find the solution to this suffering so big. And then he left and he met teachers and dedicated all his life to that, and he found one way out of suffering. And when he found the definitive, because he eliminated the two types of obstructions that are there, that are the obstructions to liberation and the obstructions to knowledge. He eliminated from his mind, through a personal work, he eliminated these two types of obstructions, and when he eliminated them, then he attained the state of liberation, and that's what is the enlightened mind, the state of a Buddha. And why it's called this way? Because it's the mind that has eliminated all these obstructions, all these impediments, and all the veils. And he developed all the qualities of the mind, and that's what it's called awakened. All this potential is inside all yours, inside yourselves, without being developed. Only you need a master that tells you how to do it, to develop them. Nothing else.
Son enseñanzas para todos los seres. Así lo pienso.
So I think that really these teachings are teachings for everyone, all living beings, to be able to eliminate all this suffering at the level that each individual is, depends on each individual where he wants to go. But these practices that you are doing only can bring benefits to your life, many benefits, to be able to live life in a more happy way, enjoying with more humor, with more capacities to confront, to face the difficult moments of life, to be able to live a life with sense. What would be a life with sense, with meaning, meaningful? That would be to take advantage of this human being, that we have this human life, and live with more consciousness. If we don't use our lives to develop these qualities and eliminate suffering. So how do we differentiate ourselves from animals if we don't take advantage of that? But if we take advantage of this, then obviously then our life will be meaningful. And to develop these qualities and this happiness, the happiness that I'm referring to, is not the happiness that the object of the five consciousness bring us. But what I mean is the happiness of better quality. That happiness is a mental state that we're going to create. It's a group of qualities that we can develop in our minds. That's the happiness that is more lastful, lasting, and truthful. Because if we base our happiness in the objects of the five consciousness, sensorial consciousness, then is a happiness, conditioned happiness. Because all these things depend on causes and conditions, and we don't have control over them. That's why it's a conditioned happiness. Because these things and people, animals, things depend on so many causes and conditions, and if they depend in causes and conditions, means that they are transitory. And if I don't know this, and I get attached to anything that has this nature, sooner or later I'm going to suffer. Independently, whether they give me the happiness that I'm searching for. Because when I do have these things, or when I search these things from the physical world, because I have to search for them, because I have to cover my necessities. And we do need these things like a house, a family, friends, people, relationships, to enjoy life. Obviously, we do need them to cover our necessities, cloth, food, well-being, medicines, all the good things that life can bring us. But how can we search? The way we search for them is what we have to be careful with. Because if I search for them with attachment, nothing outside can satisfy that happiness. Because it is the nature of transitoriness, so then it produces a lot of unsatisfaction, and this is unhappiness, a subtle unhappiness. if we want many things from the world, then we should learn how to lose also. If we are not used to lose, then we'll suffer a lot. So the meditation and all these practices will help us to get closer to who we really are, to understand what we have to eliminate from our minds and what we have to develop. It will help to understand where we have to find the true happiness and to develop those qualities, inner qualities, and search for this mental happiness, which is more important, more lasting than the happiness that the objects of the five sensorial consciousness produce. This doesn't mean that we don't have to enjoy the world. Of course we do. Of course they are there to enjoy them, to feel them and be happy as well, because they do bring some happiness, but it's not enough. If we don't have a stable, a peaceful mind, if we are not happy inside ourselves, we can have the whole world at our feet, that we won't be happy. Even if the universe, entire universe, we could transform it into gold, if you don't have mental peace, you don't be happy. And the opposite, you can have a very peaceful mind, a stable mind, strong with this heart, good heart, and there come many difficulties from outside, many things that we don't like, things that are not good in life, and not alterate your mind. To feel these emotions, to feel the sadness, obviously, to feel this loneliness, but they wouldn't change the direction of your life. They wouldn't sink you in a depression or anxiety. This doesn't mean that we have to avoid emotions. We should understand the emotions to face them with this strength, inner strength. All this can help us, and I think it's a lot. And so we can live life in a closer of who we really are, less manageable with the intentions of the ego. So before leaving, what is an obstacle to our meditation? So there are certain conditions that favor our practice, meditative practice. These conditions obviously would be a person, like for example, a person that goes to the mountain to have calm abiding, I will talk about the calm abiding. But also us that we live in the cities with other people that have responsibilities, family, work. So the first condition, it would be diminish our desires, that our desires diminish. This anxiety, this searching for things, Buddha said that is like an anxiety inside to get things. The more you have, the more you want. It's like drinking salted water. The more you drink, the never you quench your thirst. So to have a satisfied mind, that would be the second one. So to have a satisfied mind. A person that has a satisfied mind, what does this mean? To be happy with what one has. If life gives you more, then that's perfect. To be happy with what you have and to enjoy everything that you have in every moment of your life. Because if your mind is not satisfied, then it's unsatisfied because it's thinking about what you don't have and doesn't let you enjoy what you do have. So a satisfied mind is very important. Satisfied with yourself, with what you are, with what you, with your friends, family, with everything that life gives you, that you have more, then that's it. Okay, whatever life brings you, that's good. And be thankful to life. So the third one is to live, try to live a life correctly with respect to our behavior, with ourselves in the society and the life that we and the world we live in. This is ethics called. Ethics, what is ethics? Is not to harm anybody. His Holiness said, if you can't help them, at least you don't harm them. Firstly, don't harm yourself, not harming others, and to take care of the environment where we live in, basing ourselves with something very important, that because of our conditioned, energetic condition, we see everything, that everything exists on their own side without depending on anything. So there is an existence of interdependence that we don't see. But there is a relationship of interdependence of what I am and what I think I am. That's the first. There is a relation of interdependence between me and others. And there is a relation of interdependence between us and the world, physical world where we live in, and everybody can see this relation of interdependence. We cannot live independently from the rest. And basing ourselves with this relationship of interdependence, then we can live this life correctly. If I want for myself happiness and I don't want suffering, if I want well-being and I want peace, there is no one being, not even the smallest of animals, that doesn't want this. So what I want for myself, I want for the others as well. That's it. This is ethics. This correct way of living comes from inside. To understand this truth, that others want exactly the same as I want. So, if we live according to these ethics and basing ourselves towards with the relation of interdependence of cause and effect, my life will be more peaceful because we won't do actions where I will harm myself or others or the world. Then means that these afflictions correspond to these actions. If I did them, I wouldn't have them. And there in my mind would be a lot of peace, more peace. So the first thing that calms my mind down is the gross disturbing emotions. So they will calm down. And then I will live in peace. I don't criticize anybody. I don't say harsh words. I don't harm others, I don't alterate the minds of others. Also harm animals. And also the environment, the physical world. We see the relation of interdependence that there is with our health and the way it helps us and the animals. I won't extend myself with this because you can investigate a lot with this theme. So when you do this, there is a level of tranquility that we have. So the following step, or the following point that we should see that would help us with our meditation of calm abiding is eliminate which activities, superfluous activities that have no sense, we can eliminate. Activities that are senseless, that they don't benefit us, that we can eliminate from our lives. So we leave a space to do other things more important, that have more sense. Because our life is very precious, and any time we can lose it. So the following step or point would be see which kind of thoughts, if there is some thought that we have in our minds due to some things from the past or restlessness about the future, that is worrying at this moment, that doesn't let us be peaceful. Which is the thought that is distracting our minds? So, and see if there is a solution to that, which is one of the causes that doesn't let us have a good meditation. The first point, actually, I forgot the first point, which is to find the right place to meditate. ¿Es posible matar los mosquitos? From the point of view of Buddhism, is a being that has consciousness, and a being that has consciousness is a living being. A living being has consciousness and deserves all respect to live. Is the only thing I can say. Yes, I know that mosquitoes are a difficult thing. they just search for a little foot, a little of your blood. Actually, there are mosquitoes that kill us, like the mosquito of tsetse, which is very dangerous, which has killed a lot of people in the world, incredible. Perdón, la pregunta, ¿podrías formular la pregunta, por favor, así la traduzco?
Que si estar atento a la respiración.
if you are attentive to the breath and you get bored, can I change the object? Are there other objects? Yes, there are. But the thing is, when I am attentive to the breath, what will I accomplish with this? I'm asking you, how long have you been meditating on this object? 1 year, two? 1 year. And my question is, you know how many distractions eliminate this from your life, how much hyperactivity or laxity or lack of energy eliminate it from your life, how much stability, mental stability you accomplished. Did you accomplish, eliminate aversion and attachment? How much stability did you gain? That's my question. Because it's what we should know. It's not that we're going to breathe and that's it. No, I should know. I should do it correctly and I should see that this in my life gives me stability because I eliminate distractions and excitement and it gives me mental stability. And how through the breath, something so simple, I can eliminate the laxity and the mental sink and sinking and gives me mental stability and clarity. How much clarity and mental stability did you accomplish? But if you tell me, Zopa, could I meditate with another object of meditation to practice calm abiding? And I say yes. For example, are you Buddhist? You have a refuge? So instead of taking the breath, then take the image of a Buddha as an object. You visualize it like a Buddha, like 3-4 centimeters in front of you. And you have to visualize the image, not like a statue, but just like an energy, something alive in front of you. The mental image of this figure, you have it as an object of meditation. And what's going to happen? You do it. You'll see that you don't have a clarity of that image. If you have it, that's perfect. And if you don't have it, it's also good. Because at the beginning, you can, at home, to see a statue of a Buddha. You look at it, and then this image, and then you just close your eyes, and you just have the image of that figure, even if it's not so clear when you see it directly with your eyes, then it doesn't happen. It doesn't matter because when you gain mental clarity, you will end up seeing it very clearly. Why do I use the breath? Because the breath is a correct object. It's an object that helps us to eliminate our disturbing emotions, the distractions, the concepts, the mental noise. It calms down. The breath, you feel it. And when you lose it, it's very easy to recuperate it because you feel it. Also, it's a good object of meditation because it's connected with your mind. And whenever we are restless, then our breath is also alterated. When we are peaceful, our breath is fluid and calm. So I take this object because when I give the retreats, I don't know who is Buddhist and who is not. So it's good that you ask me this question because you can have many other objects of meditation, but I simplify it to not complicate it. So when you keep studying the Lam Rim and you reach calm abiding and the high view, then you'll see that there is a lot of objects for calm abiding and also for the high view as well, many that have different functions as well, and you can use them. But in my retreats, I just generalize them. I just take the breath to practice calm abiding, and I take the physical sensations for the Vipassana. So yes, you can use. If you get bored with the breathing, then no problem. You can just use the image of the Buddha to practice calm abiding. And if you go to the Lam Rim, if you go to the calm abiding, you'll see that there are different objects, and you can use any of them. So the six things I said before, for a person that goes to the mountain to meditate because he has all the knowledge of calm abiding and is prepared to go into retreat for 6 months, etc., then these requisites are very important. And the place also, but in our case, in the city or in your house, then you can take a place that you are comfortable, that you feel inspired. The person that goes to attain the real calm abiding, then this place has to have different qualities, a place that can keep the good health, that there is not so much noise, that people help him, that there is water, good conditions of life, that there is not so much noise. Many conditions, because what he wants is to accomplish calm abiding. Because I will also explain this to you, what is the attainment of the real calm abiding. Meanwhile, since you started to meditate, it's like step by step, that's the process. So from the very moment that you sit in meditation, we are accomplishing, attaining many benefits. It diminishes our attachment, our aversion, our distractions, the hyperactivity, diminishes the laxitude, our laxity. We'll have less anxious, less angry, we'll become less angry, we'll accept more the problems with more tranquility, our mind will be more stable, the hyperactivity, the distractions will correct, the laxity will, or mental agitation, it's also going to be correct, and the sickness of the mind as well, and the mind that doubts. The mind that doubts is a mind as if we were in a desert that we don't really know where we go. So the more we make our mind peaceful, stability and clarity, and eliminating all these obstacles, then the mind that doubts, that doesn't know, that loses the direction of the purpose of life, or its purpose, then it's not going to be like this. It's going to be a doubt that will go towards the correct. So the defiled doubt is the one that separates you from, that takes you to suffering. The correct doubt, it goes to, it leads you to happiness. So this doubt is going to be this way. So, but don't think that, wow, so until I don't accomplish calm abiding, I won't have any benefit. No, you still mean, from the very moment that you started to practice, you are having already benefits. Have you understood? So I think I'm going to leave it here. It's time. I have to say that the retreat that you're doing is incredible. It's quite impressive seeing it. Please carry on like this, because I see that the effort that you are putting is a very peaceful one, with enthusiasm. There is no tension, and as the retreat goes, you'll see that it's going to be easier. The 2-3 first days are a little bit harder, but then you'll see that everything is going to calm down and you'll be much better. So let's dedicate the merits that we have generated during the whole day. The positive energy that we have created all together. Dedicate all the positive energy that we have created during the whole day, like with our practice, a practice based on a motivation, altruistic motivation, a very powerful one. We dedicate this so that the suffering in the world vanish, so that all wars stopped. And all the causes that keep these wars. Cease. And we'll dedicate to all the masters, spiritual masters of all the religions that help human beings to be better beings. That they have a long life and that all their wishes come true. Because above all, of all religion, the most important thing is that a human being is a great human being, independently which philosophy or belief that practices. We'll dedicate it also to all the people that have in their hands the power of the countries, and that their decisions can lead to suffering, and some other decisions can lead to happiness of their countries. So when they take these decisions, that their minds be enough stable and peaceful to take the best decisions, the correct decisions, and they never forget others, living beings. I also dedicate to all the people that help in this world to palliate the suffering, like doctors, nurses, the Doctors Without Frontiers, or ONGs that help so much to the world, volunteers in all aspects, so that the tools, so that their strength keeps alive, and they all have health, and they have all the materials they need to keep helping. And we'll dedicate it to all the people that we know, our friends, even the people who have hurt us. Also for the people who we have hurt, that all find happiness, well-being. Also we dedicate it to ourselves that we don't have difficulties in our practices, so we can train the different aspects of our minds to be able to be of benefit, not just for ourselves, but for others. That we are free from obstacles, we have health, we have work, and good relationships. That slowly we can find the path that is inside ourselves to be able to live from our essence and to live, to give our lives meaning and to have also to our, that our death is also meaningful too. So have a nice rest.